Muito bem, estamos de volta. Estamos de volta, então, com o nosso evento. Aos que estão nos acompanhando online, bem-vindos de volta. E aos que estão nos acompanhando presencialmente, eu vou pedir para vocês retornarem aqui aos seus lugares para que a gente possa, então, dar sequência à nossa programação. Antes de seguir para o próximo painel, vocês lembram que eu pedi para vocês mandarem as fotos dos seus pets para a gente conhecer eles de perto, para que eles possam participar aqui conosco do nosso encontro? Então, agora chegou o momento da gente mostrar eles aqui na nossa tela e olhar bem para a carinha deles. Eles vão deixar a gente preparados para o que vem na sequência. Então, esses são os pets de vocês. Muito obrigada pelo envio das fotos e todos são muito gracinha. E como a gente falou no painel anterior, eles tornam a nossa vida muito melhor, especialmente nesse momento que a gente está passando no planeta todo, um momento de muitos desafios, de muitas distâncias, de muita tecnologia. Então, nesses momentos, a gente tem que ser o mais humano possível e o mais caloroso possível. Então, eles tornam a nossa vida muito melhor nesse sentido e estão aqui com a gente participando. Muito bem, a gente já tem o nosso público presencial aqui retornando aos seus lugares, e agora sim vamos retomar a nossa programação, tá bom? A partir de agora, nós vamos acompanhar um painel que vai apresentar reflexões muito importantes a respeito da competitividade do Brasil na economia global e também da elevação dos padrões para os consumidores brasileiros. Há mais de 30 anos, o Brasil é parceiro-chave da OECD, a Organização para a Cooperação e Desenvolvimento. A OECD visa elevar o padrão de atuação das empresas em todo o mundo, seja de países membros ou não. E, recentemente, a Proteste tornou-se parceira do ponto de contato nacional da OECD e está muito empenhada em difundir as diretrizes de conduta empresarial responsável em parceria com os representantes do Ministério da Economia. Então, nessa próxima sessão, nós vamos tratar justamente sobre isso. Ela será apresentada em inglês e contará com a moderação de Henrique Lian. Ele é diretor de Relações Institucionais e Mídia da Proteste. E agora, vamos receber, então, o Henrique aqui ao palco. Seja bem-vindo, Henrique. Seja bem-vindo, pode se acomodar. Muito obrigada, a gente que agradece pela sua presença aqui no nosso encontro. Antes de passar a palavra para o Henrique, eu vou, claro, chamar os nossos convidados. So now, let's welcome Mr. Allan Jorgensen. Mr. Jorgensen is head of the OECD Center for Responsible Business Conduct. So now, welcome, Mr. Jorgensen. Thank you very much for joining us in our event. And now, we'll also give a warm welcome to Reinaldo Goto. Mr. Goto is Chief Compliance Officer at BRF and represents the Brazilian National Industries Confederation, a CNI. So, welcome, Mr. Goto. Thank you for being here with us. And now I would also like to introduce Evelyn Menezes Albris. She is the General Coordinator of Investment Attraction in the Ministry of Economy. Mrs. Albris represents the national contact point for OECD guidelines for multinational companies here in Brazil. And she is here with us. So thank you very much and welcome. Be our guest. And now, Henrique, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Renata. Thank you, Mr. Jorgensen. Thanks, Goto, and thanks, Evelyn. Evelyn is a friend for such a long time that I have some difficulty to call you Mrs. Albers, but I will make an effort here. So as Renato introduced, the OECD was established in 1960, joining governments, people, and business in order to improve the world. I would say it's a very ambitious target, but that's it, how to improve the world. And as early as 1976, it launched the guidelines for multinational companies. And inside these guidelines, we have the responsible business conduct principles or guidelines. encompassing everything from human rights, information, environment, against bribery, science and technology, competition, and very important to us, consumers' needs and interests as a pillar. So the objective of this short session, I would say, is to explore how the guidelines for responsible business conduct can contribute to developing markets such as Brazil, can higher these standards. So these very special participants from the OECD and in Europe, Mr. Jorgensen, from the national point of contact for the OECD at the Ministry of Economy with Mrs. Albrecht, and a transnational Brazilian company representing CNE, represented here by Mr. Goto. So I would start from the principal with Mr. Jorgensen. We'd like to hear from you, what's your assessment concerning the implementation of the guidelines, their potential to improve the standards of non-OECD markets, and you what see ahead in the short term. To be brief, what's your summary so far in the implementation of the guidelines? The floor is yours, Mr. Jorgensen.
So to be very brief, thank you, Enrique, first of all, for having me on behalf of the OECD. It's a great pleasure to speak in this forum and also to speak in the context of the role of consumers promoting responsible business conduct. The members of the OECD, as you said, are united in the mission to create better policies for better lives. And that very much also includes building better business practices through promoting responsible business conduct. And that's the role of the OECD guidelines for multinational enterprises is really the gold standard globally for ensuring that all businesses globally conduct themselves in accordance with certain minimal rules of the game, if you will, when it comes to the many areas that you just mentioned, including when it comes to the interests and the needs of consumers. And in that area specifically, the guidelines established the expectation that companies in promoting their products are transparent and communicate with consumers in good faith, that they respect consumers' right to, for example, data privacy, but also that they strive to actually enable and empower consumers to make more informed decisions based on the social and environmental attributes of the product that the company is marketing. So its environmental impacts, its labor-related impacts, for example. What is very particular about the OECD guidelines for multinational enterprises, and as my colleague will also comment on much more, is that as part of their implementation, in all the 50 countries that have signed up to promoting the guidelines, you actually have national authorities that are tasked with that obligation to promote the guidelines within their country to the businesses in their country, but also to facilitate access to remedy in cases where the guidelines may not be upheld by businesses operating in or from their country. In this case, in Latin American context, there are a number of such national contact points. And it's actually interesting to have a look at some of the cases that have related in recent years to the consumer area. In Australia, as one example, there is currently a case brought by an NGO which is trying to require of the financial institution in Australia that this bank disclose more information about the climate impact and policies of the bank in order to make financial consumers more able to assess whether the bank and the products that the bank is selling are actually aligned with the goals of the Paris Agreement. In another similar case in Europe a few years ago, a consumer organization complained that a major energy company was engaging in misleading advertising of some of its low carbon products, and subsequently that advertising was also stopped. Now, these cases illustrate that through the OECD system, there is actually a vibrant discussion about responsible business conduct in practice, where consumers can play a key role. And this is happening not just in the 50 countries that are adhering to the guidelines, but actually globally, which I will also come back to. Now, what we have seen in recent years also, an extension of that discussion, Enrique, is a very fast growth in the number of certification schemes and labels that deal with sustainable products, sustainable business practices. Consumers see them more and more in the products that they are buying, whether that be chocolate or coffee or clothing or electronics. And that is essentially a positive thing, because that means that the OECD guidelines are actually implemented by businesses themselves in the context of these certification schemes and industry initiatives. What can be very challenging for the individual consumer is, of course, to navigate in all of these standards, to actually be able to tell whether the standards are living up to the minimum requirements that are contained in OECD standards and standards by the United Nations, etc. So as part of an effort to make it simpler, not just for consumers, but also for investors, policymakers, and others to make sense of that landscape, the OECD members have actually established a platform that enables us to assess whether different certification schemes, different labeling schemes, to what extent do they actually cover in an effective way the things that we as consumers expect of the products we buy, whether that be from a human rights perspective, a labor rights perspective, an environmental perspective, or a data privacy perspective, for example. But that's back to the point that this is happening in a lot of countries. There's a vibrant discussion about this. We're still seeing the tip of the iceberg, but consumers are playing, fortunately, a more and more active role. And we're hoping through some of the work at the OECD to put consumers in an even better position going forward to actually require better business conduct, more sustainable business conduct when they make their purchasing decisions, whether that be financial services or products or different types of consumption.
Thank you very much, and thank you for focusing on consumers and their needs. And since we are in a consumerist forum, we used to say that consumers are the largest pressure group in society because everyone is a consumer, although we do not perceive ourselves as a pressure group with specific interests. Coming to Brazil, Mrs. Albers, Evelyn, coming to Brazil, we know the importance of the national contact points for the OECD, whether in fostering better public policies, engaging companies, or even treating problems when a company is not following in Brazil their OECD guidelines from the headquarters. So I would like you to summarize for us the main challenges of the Brazilian national point of contact, and also, if you can, what value you see in partnering with a consumer's organization in the promotion of the responsible business conduct guideline, please.
Thank you very much, Henrique. I will call you Henrique for sure.
Please.
Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here, and thank you again for having this opportunity to co-host this session on RBC. So an important matter, and thanks to Alan and to Goto for accepting our invitation. And without further delay, I would like to add something to Alan's speech. Speaking a little more about NECPs, these national contact points that we call NECPs. So we have a twofold role. The first one is to disseminate, to make awareness of the OECD guidelines. And the second one is to act as a non-judicial grievance mechanism, as a remedy mechanism. So as Henrique just mentioned, we also receive complaints. So we deal with concrete problems regarding the OECD guidelines implementation in Brazil and in all 50 countries. And we always say that NECPs are really unique mechanisms. And this may sound like overreacting sometimes, and I don't think so. I will explain why. Imagine if all international multilateral agreements, instruments, have someone to say, you need to comply with this. If you don't do, we may be called into action. So anyone, any one of you that are here in São Paulo or in any part of the world may say, this multinational enterprise or this company is not in compliance with the OECD guidelines, with the human rights chapter or the consumer chapter. And then we go and we try to reach a dialogue with the company on that subject. This is really special. This is really unique. And this made the OECD guidelines not a paper instrument. So here in Brazil, the National Contact Point was created in 2003. And it's currently an interagency working group. It has 10 public bodies and is coordinated by us at the Trade Chamber at the Ministry of Economy. So this is the configuration of the NECP in Brazil. They have many different structures worldwide. Coming back to your question, the NECP help companies to implement the OECD guidelines by promoting them, by dealing with these concrete problems, and to providing training on the OECD guidelines and due diligence guidance and many other subjects. And an important point to make is that the companies are not obliged to be in compliance with the OECD guidelines. But the governments are obliged have to establish NECPs and work for their implementation. So we need to do that. And consumers have an important role on that too. We always mention that companies don't need to follow the OECD guidelines, but there is a reputational factor. So if they are in compliance with the OECD guidelines and other integrity, sustainable compliance instruments, if they go beyond law, they may attract further investments and they may be in the attention of the consumers. So that's why being in this partnership with Proteste is so important. Being here at the Euroconsumers Forum is so important because consumers are able to push companies to adopt better RBC standards. So that's the main message. Sorry. The NECP work for the implementation, but other stakeholders are also a part of this environment to push, to boost RBC practices in Brazil and in all 50 countries, and consumers are a huge part of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and we are very excited to be your partner in the promotion of the directives. Maybe a little later I come to that, but now I need to make a question to Mr. Reinaldo Goto, and who is representing the National Industries Confederation, CNE, and he is compliance officer from BRF. My question to you is a business one, Mr. Goto. When you take voluntarily these guidelines, you are raising your standards. My question to you is, how a Brazilian company or Latin America company, which was not born in the OECD environment, can take the guidelines, raise the practice, and keep competitiveness? Because we know that your competitors not always raise the standards. So you are internalizing practices and costs that your competitors don't have. So what's the importance of following the guidelines and how to keep being competitive?
So thank you very much, Ivan, to to have me in this call. And once again, thank you very much, Enrique and also Evelyn. It's a quite pleasure to share with you some of our experience. Yeah. I fully agree with you, Mr. Robinson, words that customers are one of the main drivers for the adoption of the OECD guidelines, but also not only the consumers, but from the other side, also the capital market is also pressures a lot for that. Yeah. In this sense, we have this scenario in Brazil that the capital is more and more global, and also the consumers are extremely global. And we also have global players here in Brazil that request us to follow the responsible business of the guidelines for multinational enterprise. In that sense, as you may mention, in the first impression, you may say that you lose competitiveness, but in the other hand, it's the opposite way. Because if you look mainly for the Brazilian industry and in a closer evaluation for the agricultural business or the agribusiness, we export for more than 200 countries nowadays. Yeah. We are going to have an extraordinary and a record volume this year, surpassing maybe $120 billion, that represent more than 50% of our exports and also more than 20% of our jobs. Yeah. Brazil is the number one exporter in several fields like orange juice, coffee, pulp and paper, animal proteins, and soybeans, sugarcane, also including mining and oil and gas. And therefore, if we can show that we can keep the competitiveness, as you mentioned, but also follow all the guidelines from the OECD, looking for the human rights, employment, industry relationship. As Mr. Jorgis mentioned, we have also a very robust legal framework here in Brazil, not only looking for the antitrust matters, but also anti-corruption matters, and most recently also taking special closed concerns about also the data privacy. All in all, we clearly believe that it's possible to fulfill with all the guidelines and not only keep the competitiveness, but really raise the bars and compete in the global market.
Thank you very much, Reinaldo. Now, as a moderator, I have the microphone, so I will make a question to myself, just to give some compliments. Why we are partnering with OECD, or better saying, supporting OECD. We have two beliefs. The first belief is that dialogue is very important. So we are a consumers organization that works in partnership with companies and work in partnerships with governments, academia, and other organizations. We don't see that we have all the answers. We don't see even that we have all the questions, all the right questions. So this multi-stakeholder dialogue is very important to us. And on the other hand, we believe that national regulations must be the floor of business practice, never the ceiling. So we are always stimulating Brazilian companies to adopt higher and higher standards in all the areas we mentioned before, from the human rights to consumers' protection, and go beyond the law, which is exactly what the OECD guidelines propose. So we are not yet a OECD country, but we are part of the OECD complex. The government adopted the OECD guidelines, signed it. We have signed 100 documents from the OECD out of 300. And now we are engaging companies in going beyond. So that's why we are partners. But remaining in the legal field, I want you to explore with Mr. Jorgensen the problem of voluntary commitments. The problem or the solution of voluntary commitments. So the OECD guidelines are voluntary. They are soft law by nature. But sometimes some guidelines become legal regulation in some countries. So they pass through a process of densification, legal densification. From hard law, they become, from soft law, they become hard law. I would hear from you how you see this process, if it is thriving, developing, and if you think it's a good thing or it's better to count on self-regulation and soft law always.
Thank you, Enrique. It's true that the OECD guidelines for multinational enterprises are, from a company perspective, are soft law. They are guidelines from governments to companies. It's also true that many of the areas that the guidelines touch on, you mentioned human rights, labor standards, in many countries, including in Brazil, these are actually also legal requirements, also in the health and safety area, in the environmental protection area. And what the guidelines try to do is set a common minimum threshold across global supply chains so that companies can also compete better on an equal or more level playing field. It's also true that many of our laws that exist, unfortunately, are not well implemented for various reasons. So the OECD is actively engaged also in building capacity and working with our partners to build capacity both of policymakers, of institutions in the countries, and also of businesses. In the Latin America region, the OECD is working very closely with the International Labour Organization, as well as the Office of the Human Rights Commissioner of the United Nations to promote responsible business conduct throughout the region. Since we started this collaboration in 2019, we have engaged with more than 2,000 companies directly in this process, and thousands of participants have been through our trainings, including both public officials, but also people from companies. And part of the activities we are conducting also from the OECD is to actually help the countries look at their legal frameworks, look at their policy frameworks, how well do the laws and the implementation of the laws actually correspond to the OECD standards on responsible business conduct. And thereby to drive, you could say, in an implementation and improvements in the legal framework so that companies such as BRF, who are doing, you can say, a leadership effort on a voluntary basis, can also be more competitive because you will have a better level playing field for responsible business conduct in the countries. At the same time, we also have to remember that increasingly our companies are not just competing in global, in local markets, they are competing in global markets where sustainability requirements, including from investors in terms of environmental and social and governance criteria, are starting to become really a factor of competitiveness for companies wanting to be part of global supply chains. We're seeing that across many sectors in all regions. So to be competitive and to be a supplier and a business partner to some of the largest companies in the world today, you have to actually live up to quite stringent requirements in terms of responsible business conduct. In terms of the policy side of that, it is becoming more and more common also to see responsible business conduct and sustainable development provisions being integrated into trade agreements between countries and between different regions. For example, in the EU-Mexico trade agreement or the EU Mercosur trade agreement, the US, Mexico-Canada trade agreement, you will find quite rigorous provisions on labor standards and so forth. So also from, say, that perspective, this space is becoming less and less voluntary. In some regions, we are also seeing efforts now to make responsible business conduct practices legally mandated. So there is a proposal for such a law now in Europe and in a number of other countries also. And there are also growing requirements, if you will, on reporting. So how companies share information with investors and with other interested stakeholders on responsible business conduct practices, especially in relation to climate change. And those requirements are also growing in the legal sense, but also in the, say, in the non-legal space as requirements actually to gain access to finance. So as Mr. Kotu noted, this is very rapidly becoming a critical factor for the long-term value creation of companies, and for the competitiveness of companies in global value chains. We're seeing an increasing uptake in terms of the legal framework also in the Latin American region as part of the processes we're undertaking with our member governments in the region.
Thank you very much. Some of the topics you have addressed, like the climate change, fossil fuels policies, we're going to be dealing in one of our next sessions when we talk about the Brazilian foreign trade and the trade policy. Thank you very much. So we are all at the same page now that the OECD guidelines are voluntary for companies, but not for countries, not for governments. So Evelyn, I want to explore that phase with you. So governments must implement and must lead by example and help their national private sectors to implement. So in Brazil, what are the main challenges in NCP to have better public policies stimulating companies to adhere to the guidelines?
Thank you, Henrique. Very important question to be addressed in a couple of minutes. I will try to raise some of the challenges and opportunities. As I mentioned earlier, the NCPs help companies and are legally binding to do mainly two things: to promote the guidelines and to work as non-grievance mechanisms, but non-judicial grievance mechanisms. But we also have a third role that is closely related to your question, that is working for better RBC coordination and policy coherence. That's why governments are trying to discuss it at the OECD Working Party on Responsible Business Conduct. In fact, we are working finalizing a recommendation that will sum up most of governments' agreements on RBC and our responsibilities on promoting RBC and helping countries to implement it. So how could we do it? This is a challenge in a country like Brazil that is complex, that has many regulations, many different companies, and we have lots of small and medium-sized enterprises that add some complexity to this discussion too. But we may act as also economic actors, as we are discussing at the Working Party. In this sense, we may work with sticks and carrots. So we may help, and we may value good behavior, and maybe sometimes not value not so good behavior. I will give some examples. For a good example, I think, is our bidding law in Brazil. It had already some sustainable clauses, and recently the new law has added some new clauses on integrity, on compliance programs. So companies need to have specific criteria to be able to sell to the government or to make partnerships, etc. This is kind of a stick. We also have some interesting programs on the carrot side. I met you and Goto a couple of years ago in the context of the ProEtica, the ProEtics compliance program from the Office of the Comptroller General. They value good behavior. They promote. They have a seal for companies that have good integrity programs. We also now have a program like that for infrastructure, the Plus Integrity for agriculture. So we have many programs in the government to also praise and value good behavior. That's a way to work and to deal with the complexities too. Besides that, we have some more structured actions, and I would like to mention the RBC action plan that's now being implemented, being written in the context of CONINVI, our National Investment Committee, and will be adopted by August 2022. And the main objectives of this plan is first to map initiatives. So what's going on in Brazil on RBC from the public sector, the private sector, and also the third sector? A next step will be how to help to have better measures. So we will work with our public and private partners to implement better public policies to boost RBC in Brazil. Besides that, that actions from our members like Proética and like the bidding law and this PASER initiative, that is this more structured plan, we also work in partnerships with many initiatives like the Laboratório de Inovação Financeira, the UN Global Compact, now with Proteste too. So we are more than available to help companies to understand the OECD guidelines. As Alan mentioned, to see that most of the things companies already do, and maybe sometimes they need just to associate with the role of the OECD guidelines and their national instrument. And we are here, the NCP is here for that. Thank you. Back to you, Henrique.
Thank you very, very much, Evelyn. We still have time for one question to Reinaldo Goto. Again, it's a business question, Reinaldo. And we know that the guidelines are voluntary, and some companies from OECD area, when they come to Brazil, they low down their standards. We call this operational dumping. So they have more profitable, they are more profitable because they are not doing the same kind of standards and operation they do in Europe or Japan or the US. But the same happens with Brazilian companies when we go abroad to Africa or to Latin America. So sometimes a Brazilian company goes to Africa and lowers down its standards, its Brazilian standards. So my question to you is, how the guidelines for a Brazilian company who voluntarily assumes and adheres to the guideline can prevent this kind of practice so that when a Brazilian company goes abroad, it at least keeps its commitments taken in Brazil with OECD, for instance?
Thank you very much for the question, Henrique. And here in Brazil specifically, I think that we have a little bit different situation. First of all, the describe is completely incorrect and unacceptable. Yeah? But here in Brazil, different also from other countries, you're not going to find a product that is really usually labeled as made in Japan, made in Italy, made in US. From time to time, you are going to see a product labeled like made for export. Yeah, for export. It means that we put even more quality in the products that goes abroad compared to the product that is selling here in Brazil. That's also our wrong mindset in my most of the companies like BRF are putting the same efforts for the local market as well for the international market. The guidelines is extremely accurate also on that, as putting a lot of efforts to the companies to perform the so-called due diligence. Due diligence is not only a practice related to joint matters, so for all the new fields that we are looking for, like human, environmental, and therefore, I think that the guidelines is once again an excellent platform for the international to not only to compete, but also for the correct business conducts, and it goes to any market in the world.
Thank you very much, Reinaldo. I thank you very much. Our very special guest is Mr. Jorgensen, talking from Europe, head of the Center for the Responsible Business Conduct Guidelines, and Reinaldo Goto, representing CNE, and he's the head of compliance for BRF, and especially Evelyn and the Brazilian National Point of Contact for co-organizing this session, inviting these very special guests to be here with us today, and inviting to protest to support this very important initiative. Thank you very much, and you can count on us.
Thank you, Henrique. It's great. It's great to be here and to have these important discussions and in a forum like that. Thank you very much. And I think it will be pivotal to overcome the challenges from the pandemic, and we are in the right path. Thank you.
And thank you for taking the time to come to São Paulo. You are traveling to Sweden. You're traveling to Sweden in the weekend. Thank you for taking the time.
Thank you.
In a few minutes, we will start another panel. Thank you for being with us.